Welcome to Decision Vision, a podcast series focusing on critical business decisions. Brought to you by Brady Ware & Company. Brady Ware is a regional, full-service accounting and advisory firm that helps businesses and entrepreneurs make visions a reality.
And welcome to Decision Vision, a podcast giving you, the listener, clear vision to make great decisions. In each episode, we discuss the process of decision-making on a different topic. Rather than making recommendations because everyone's circumstances are different, we talk to subject matter experts about how they would recommend thinking about that decision. My name is Mike Blake, and I'm your host for today's program. I'm a director at Brady Ware & Company, a full-service accounting firm based in Dayton, Ohio, with offices in Dayton, Columbus, Ohio, Richmond, Indiana, and Alpharetta, Georgia, which is where we are recording today. Brady Ware is sponsoring this podcast. If you like this podcast, please subscribe on your favorite podcast aggregator, and please also consider leaving a review of the podcast as well. So our topic today is cooperating with competitors, and this is a ticklish topic. You know, we think of competitors in the marketplace, regardless of our industry. It could be public accounting, it could be advisory, it could be manufacturing cars, it could be airlines. Very few businesses are not in a competitive scenario in some case. And by the way, if you are in a business that isn't in one, please write me. I'd like to know what that is so I can then compete with you, because that sounds great. And what I've learned over the last, 15 years or so that I've been in business is that, some industries just can't get along. Like years ago, I did a project for Coca-Cola Enterprises, and I was a contract there doing some financial analysis. And at the time, you walk into their office and everything is Coca-Cola red, and they got polar bears all over the place and bottles of Coke and everything else. And it's definitely rah-rah, sort of company branding is at the forefront. And if I did not do this, but somebody else I knew did, went off premises and then came back with a bag full of Taco Bell, which is, at the time, was owned by PepsiCo, now Yum Brands. I don't know if Pepsi's owned by them or not. But that was a big no-no. Like, even having food from the competing beverage was not a fireable offense, but boy, you got the Coca-Cola stink eye and then some when you did that. I imagine there was a time when you had that kind of rivalry at Microsoft and Apple. I don't think that's the case today. And we think of competition as something that, frankly, we have to destroy, that they are enemies, that they are opposing us, that they are taking food out of our mouths, and that they're are something to be feared and disliked. But I think in modern business, that's not necessarily always the case. And you see industries where, in certain cases, competitors do band together. The auto industry, as competitive as they are, they do band together in order to promote safety in their industry. They band together to make sure that regulations aren't too constraining. In the airline industry, I think the same thing is true. You see partnerships all over the place where maybe companies are cross-selling each other's services. And maybe I'll go back to airlines. They're actually a really good example too, because they do co-chairing. So, my family and I are going to take a trip to Scandinavia later this year. And, our plane ticket says Delta, but, at some point we're probably going to be put on an SAS plane or a Norwegian airplane or something. We don't know that, but because those are competitors that are cooperating, right? That's the kind of customer experience that we're going to have. And because they cooperate, we don't have to get out at Paris and then walk the rest of the way to Copenhagen, which would be a real pain in the neck. And so I wanted to explore this because in my particular practice, and I don't know if I'm exceptional in either direction or right about the average, but I can tell you in my practice and business valuation, about somewhere between 20 and 30% of my business actually comes from competing firms. And I don't necessarily know that I'm exceptional, but on the off chance that it is exceptional in some way, that means that there's a lesson to learn. I want to talk about what if your competitors aren't your mortal enemies? What if you're not just always locked in a life and death struggle with your competitors, and not in a way where you're forming a cartel? I mean, our firm is not big enough. We're not going to cartel anything. But there's a big gap between cartel and cutthroat winner take all competition. And so that's what I want to talk about today, because if you're not thinking about competitors in the terms of if there's a potential partnership and a potential cooperation opportunity, you may be leaving money on the table. You may be leaving business value on the table. And maybe also you're leading a more stressful life than you have to. And so I brought in a guest today that I think this will be a little bit of a different conversation, because I'm going to be more of an active participant rather than an interviewer. But I brought in my friend Tom Brooks today, who is a competitor with whom that I cooperate quite a bit. Tom is a director in the Valuation and Litigation Services Group of Windham Brannon PC, a mid-sized certified public accounting firm in Atlanta. I think about the same size as Brady Ware. I haven't measured it, but I get the sense we're about roughly the same size. Tom has over 20 years of experience handling valuation and litigation support matters. He specializes in guiding clients with the valuation of their businesses, business interests, and intangible assets for mergers and acquisitions, gift and estate planning, financial and tax reporting, charitable giving, strategic planning, shareholder disputes, commercial litigation, and marital dissolution. Tom has worked with businesses of all sizes, including startup companies to larger companies with over $1 billion in revenues. He is effective at communicating complex valuation issues and collaborating with his clients and building successful relationships. Prior to joining Windham Brannon, he was a senior manager in the valuation practice of a leading tax and advisory firm. As a licensed CPA in Georgia, accredited in business valuation, and as an accredited senior appraiser, Tom often speaks for organizations such as the Atlanta National Association for Certified Valuation Analysts, or NACVA. That has got to be the weirdest, most awkward acronym in the history of mankind, and I'm a NACVA member, so I can speak to that internally. The Georgia Society of Certified Public Accountants, and Atlanta Alumni of Retired Revenue Agents. He has also presented for Georgia Tech and LaGrange College accounting students and at Merrill Lynch seminars. And Tom and I used to work together, and he won't admit this, but I actually worked for him, technically at least, 15 years ago. And we have tracked each other's careers and have been good friends ever since. And it's a terrific pleasure to have Tom Brooks in the program. Tom, thanks for coming on.
No, it's great to be on, Mike. I appreciate it. That's quite an intro, and I think it makes me sound a little better than I really am. And yeah, you really didn't work for me, Mike. That wasn't really the case.
So, you see, he's only saying that so that if I do something bad, he doesn't want the blame for it. So talk to us a little bit about your practice in Windham Brannon. How big is that practice, generally speaking? I'm not looking for a number of terms or anything. And what do you focus on within that practice?
Yeah, our practice highlights a lot of what you highlighted in my bio, which is a mouthful, but traditional business valuation of privately held entities, number of reasons that clients may perform those. You've probably talked about those a lot on your program and on the podcast here, but we do a lot of work around exit planning for our clients, management planning, which can be very broad, to keeping a scorecard. What's my business worth? Why am I the investments that I'm making, the growth that I'm achieving, why is that happening and how does that impact value? We do a lot of work as a firm, Windham Brannon. We've got a large high net worth practice. So we do a lot of work with our high net worth clients that have their businesses, and they may be looking at transition planning. How do we transition the business to the next generation? If there's no next generation, what's the next, how do we exit? And then financial reporting, and for accounting purposes, valuation for purchase price allocations, goodwill impairment, stock compensation. And then finally, probably the last piece to our puzzle in terms of our jigsaw puzzle of our practice would be litigation support in terms of commercial litigation cases and where valuation comes into play in those. Our practice has been in existence now for 18 months. And we have, we practice as a litigation and valuation group together. We've got two partners and a senior manager in that group. So I will say that I've been announced as a new principal in the firm, Mike. So.
Oh, congratulations. We heard it here first.
So it's a great, it's been a good, we've had a good, very successful start in the 18 months that I've been.
That is great. That is great to hear. I know that was kind of the plan when you joined, but I know you never take anything for granted. And that road to principal can be a bumpy one too. So we'll amend that bio. You are a principal now at Windham Brannon, Your Excellency.
don't go there, Mike.
So you have chosen, I think, in your career, really, to be pretty open about competing, about cooperating with competing firms, not just ours, but others. We don't need to be exclusive. So, but why is that? Why do you have that outlook and that philosophy?
I think it all comes back to, and this may be a recurring theme this afternoon. It comes back to trust. I mean, it's not, I'm not an open book that you, no matter who I sit down with in terms of my competitors. But I'm not afraid to ask questions when you develop that level of trust with somebody to say, am I handling this client situation right? And it's not like we're sitting here sharing our Rolodex of client names and revealing that. It's talking more about issues that we may face as practitioners. And again, I'm sure these are topics that you've talked about. If we were to talk about technical topics in valuation, you and I could have two very different approaches, and they may not be, or they could be similar. So much of our, in the career field of valuation, frequently it's said that, it may be more science or more art than science, rather. And so why wouldn't you, in my case, I think it's just kind of how I'm wired as well. Why wouldn't you open yourself up and be trustworthy of some other folks potentially? Again, it's not everybody, but those that over time you develop a relationship like that with, you've just got to develop that high level of trust before you can get to where you're going to kind of, be a friendly competitor.
And I'll interject here. I think another ingredient to that is ego. I think in the valuation profession, more than most other areas of accounting, ego is more prominent and more pronounced, right? And we both know practitioners that whatever other faults they have, healthy self-esteem is not one of them.
Right.
Right. And I do think that our profession sometimes encourages or discourages that. I think our profession sometimes a little bit more water coolery, nobody is either a genie. Nobody is either sort of, is good or maybe good in a certain area, but we tend to put people in the bucket. They're either a genius or an idiot, right? Not learning, not trending, whatever, right?
Right.
And I think part of the willingness to cooperate is a willingness to be vulnerable. Right. And say, look, I don't know everything about this. Right. We do some estate and gift tax work, but you do 10 times more work there. And that's okay. I'm willing to say, look, I don't think I need to necessarily give up the engagement, but I do need to sort of phone a friend. Right.
No, I've got other, and you and I have probably, yes, talked about issues like that. And there have been issues that I've raised around technology that I've phoned you about. And I have other, former coworkers and now competitors that, again, have very good relationships with the same thing. You referenced the gift and estate. They'll call and say, hey, I'm dealing with this issue. I don't deal with it that often. Usually it's most of the time, even you or somebody else are going to call and say, here's the way I'm thinking about it. They're not asking you to solve their problem. They're asking you to help them. And you may take them in a completely different direction, but that does speak, to that vulnerability to be willing to listen and ask somebody and say, okay, there's a better way to do it than the way I'm thinking about it. And I want to go find the right way because that's the best answer for your client.
Yeah. And you learn something, right?
Right.
And one question you have to ask later. Yeah. And you mentioned something I hadn't thought of, but I think is a really important point. My father was in this industry too, but he had two jobs over the course of his career. I think I'm on number 8 now, and I've got at least 17 or 18 years of work left in me, give or take health. So will this be my last job? I don't know. I think we all hope it is. That's why I'm a director, but we're now building networks of people that we worked with in our generation and subsequent generations much more rapidly than I think generations before us, aren't we? And that probably contributes to this, doesn't it?
I think that's the case. And again, this is not there's no poll data to back it up, but I think you're right. I think especially on, and I can't speak to any other platform other than accounting firms. That's where I've spent most of my career. But you do at times get that hesitancy and sense, and maybe it is from some of the older partners or the generation before us. And it's not to say all of them are that way, but there can be a very strong hesitancy. Well, Tom, you want to refer our client that we can't do work for to another accounting firm. And that is one reason I would say our success has been great at Windham Brannon, because my partners aren't thinking that way. But I've seen it throughout life in terms of my career, and I've seen it, other practitioners will tell me the same thing, that they've experienced some of those same, roadblocks when you do want to have this healthy, friendly, competitive, nature to your relationship.
Well, and you and I have had that, because the firm I used to work for before Brady Ware was of that mind, was that just referring stuff to another CPA firm, that was just not on the table.
Right.
And it killed me that I had to basically tell you that, because I didn't want you to refer stuff thinking there was stuff coming back, because it would not.
Right.
And it did not. So that was a very liberating thing about sort of planting my flag. And I think now that other firm has sort of started to loosen up a little bit in terms of sharing. But, you know, that can be a real issue. And I'll admit, maybe 10 years ago, I might have had 10, 12 years ago, I might have had that same mindset. You just got to hold on to every client like they're the last life vest on the Titanic. Right. But then, you know, it's with us especially, you know, we can get into something what I call evaluation Vietnam, where you think you're getting into something that's going to turn out fine, and then you get in and you're not, and it's not. And you look back, you think, boy, I'm not sure I should have taken that on.
Right.
But halfway through, you're kind of committed. You just got to figure it out. And you learn that, you know, I don't know that I even did myself a favor by taking every, you know, if Tom were here doing this, he'd have been done 3 weeks ago.
Right.
And here I am tearing my hair out at 2 a.m. trying to figure out this problem. And I think there's a maturity element to that.
Now, time, teaches you a lot in any form of, no matter what your career choice is. I believe that, especially when you listen to business owners and entrepreneurs. We've all failed probably in some capacity somewhere, and it's how do you learn from that? And again, it's taking the ego out of it and being willing to learn and being open, you know. I think it's along the same lines. It's, you know, when we're told no, or, you know, we don't win an assignment, you know, probably when I first started, that would have hurt me a lot more than it does now. You know, you have to lose some engagements to figure some things out and to learn a little bit more about how people view you in the marketplace. And, so I think it just goes to some humility along the way too, that you learn and you make some mistakes and, being willing to learn from those. And it, you know, so again, as you age and mature in your business career, hopefully you become more open to these types of concepts.
And I think it helps to have definition in terms of what you just know in your heart of hearts you're not very good at doing. I've been very open with you and anybody who will listen. I don't do litigation. I'm not very good at it. And I'm not willing or interested to make the investment required to become even mediocre at it.
Right. So,
and being a mediocre expert witness, that's a bad day, being deposed when you know you're not that great. And you know, that is maturity, but I think it's also liberating. And I think in a certain way too, it actually helps your brand, right? I don't get a lot of litigation referrals anymore either now, because the market is known, like, you know, Blake is just not going to do it. But I think that also then that tends to lead to more projects that you are good at being sent your way. And I think the market respects you more when you'll turn them down, right?
I agree. I mean, what you and I do is professional services. This isn't just about being a CPA. And for, you know, listeners out there, especially in the professional services arena, this is really what it gets back to. It's your firm's reputation, and some people may have their own firm, so the name may go, your individual name may go with the firm name. But at the end of the day, as a practicing, you know, valuation specialist at Windham Brannon, it's both my reputation and the firm's reputation every day that are on the line. And that's a risk that I have to manage as a practice leader and with firm leadership when you have questions about, you know, engagements that you may or may not want to take on. But like you said, it's kind of one of those, maybe I would have been better off, but thinking ahead and as you encounter, you know, something that is going to be considered maybe outside your comfort zone, doesn't mean that we don't take all assignments outside our comfort zone, because sometimes it relates to something we've done before and you just got to stretch yourself and learn, like you said earlier in the podcast. And that's what we, you know, many times that's the way we take new task on or responsibilities, is we learn, and some of it for us is on the job, and you know, we don't have all the answers, as you said, but sometimes it's almost like you know, phone a friend, right? I mean, that's what you just talked about, and sometimes those things will help you kind of navigate those challenging situations. But having those open relationships that you can do that, you know, to use your word, it's liberating to be able to know that, hey, in the event that I'm struggling with something, I've got a lifeline out there to help me, you know, make sure that I'm doing the right thing for my client.
So I like to revisit the trust discussion, because I think so much of it ultimately comes down to that. And there are two areas I want to explore. One is, what are some of those dimensions of trust? It's obvious part of it is going to be just, are you competent, right? I'm going to give you the fine china. Don't drop it, please. But there are kind of other elements of trust that belong there too, right? So can you talk a little bit about kind of what those trust features look like?
Yeah, I think that's one of the things in thinking about what we were going to talk about today, as I went through in my head, it's kind of the, like you said, the opposite potentially of trust. You know, there's, like you get to see a lot of work product come across your desk of your competitors, whether it be just that one of your partners is asking you to review something because they had a valuation done by an outside firm, or maybe it's on the accounting side that our audit team needs something reviewed and I'm looking at it. So the first element is kind of that competency. You know, it's just kind of that, does the expert that we may send this out to, do they have the competency and will they be taken care of? The way I think of it is, you know, as well as, will my client or the firm's client be taken care of as well as they would have been taken care of by me? So it really does come down to that trust. Some of it is just years and years. In my case, it's years. I mean, I think have trusted each other a lot longer probably than just the 10, 15 years. And we departed the firm that we work with together, but you know, it's also developed over time. And so there's a time element to it, because you got to get to know the person. I think you have to also understand, and I think maybe this is an element of trust, is, are they motivated to do the right thing? You know, again, I think that's something that you've got to gauge. There's a high level of, in doing this, you know, there's nothing that we can grab at and grasp. There's nothing tangible. All this is intangible, and there's risk associated with that, you know, when you do that, when you're putting yourself out there, and potentially, you know, handing another name off. So I think it's that, you know, again, at the end of the day, these are all elements of trust, but really that is the key element at the end of the day to kind of, that you got to come back to.
Now, the second part I want to ask about trust is, you know, trust between the two direct participants, such as between you and me, is great, but it's not enough, right? We also have to have organizational trust. And unless you have another announcement to make, you're not the managing partner of your firm.
Nope.
And I'm not the managing partner of my firm. And there's no danger of that announcement ever being made. I can promise you that.
This side as well.
So, you know, in our case, in the case of many people, we also had to help build organizational trust, right?
Absolutely. That was, you know, when you and I first landed at between Brady Ware and Windham Brannon, was one of the first things that we did, because our moves kind of coincided.
They're a month apart.
Yeah. Was, we got together for breakfast with our managing partners and some of our other key senior partners. And, you know, you just to begin to develop that rapport and that openness. And, you know, again, those lines of communication, maybe this is the word I was looking for in the prior answer, but transparency. And again, it doesn't mean that we're coming with a client roster list and going, here's yours, and we're just exchanging names like that.
Like lineup cards.
Right. Client confidentiality still trumps all this and precedes all this. So that's the utmost important thing that we have, is to maintain. But again, in that confidence, that's where your trust comes in. So, but it does take, in our case, where you're with a larger firm, you know, organizationally, you've got to have that confidence, because many times for you and I, it's not just something that comes across my desk that comes through, say, a referral to me from one of my outside sources outside the firm. It's something inside the firm. So my partners have to trust that, again, that, and have that confidence that Mike Blake and Brady Ware are going to take care of them. And so you're right. Organizational trust on top of the individual, you know, relational trust that exists is really critical as well.
And take care of them and not try to exploit the opportunity too, right?
Yeah, that that becomes an underlying element. And I think that's goes back to when we talk about some of the distrust that occurs within many firms and across probably every professional service line there is that you would have in terms of thinking about sending a potential client out to a competitor is right. What are they going to poach him completely? Or are they going to be looking to market other service lines in there? And you've got to have those conversations and they're just really open and direct. Those were not, you know, I would share when we had ours, you know, those were not difficult conversations. It was just, you know, well, here's how we conduct ourselves. And, you know, it's I guess it's kind of like dating, you know, I mean, it's kind of like we were just, you know, figuring each other out, so to speak. And, you know, and in our case, it's worked really well that, you know, again, between us and the relationship we already had and then our partners, it's just gone, you know, where we're able to do that.
So sometimes there can be speed bumps in a partnership, right? And these are by definition, they're sensitive relationships. And there's no, you know, no matter how long the trust is, there always can be a speed bump. And to my mind, I'm always kind of worried that, oh boy,
you know, what Tom do now?
Well, no, anybody, right?
Right. No.
I will tell you that, you know, I kind of tell our people, right? This is a Windham Brannon referral. This has got to be reddest of red carpets on this one because I don't want to go back and tell – I don't want to face him if it's not great. But, you know, there can be speed bumps. And, you know, how do you what do you think is the best way to kind of handle those speed bumps so that they don't jeopardize the broader relationship?
I think it goes back to what we just articulated and spoke about in our last answer was that, you know, it's got to be open lines of communication and transparency. You know, you're right. I mean, even if I never handed that client off and I could have done the work for whatever reason, you know, clients are complex in terms of the issues that we face and the demands that we face, the time, whether it be, you know, the demands are just numerous and that's, you know, it's what we sign up for. We love the serving our clients, but that hiccup could have occurred with anybody. So, So I think it's just important to know that, you know, again, take the ego out of it. None of us are perfect. None of us has, you know, again, these are intangible issues that we're dealing with typically with clients. You know, the technical issues, yes, but relational, this is all soft skills. These aren't hard, tangible skills. So, I think it's, you know, again, having that open line of communication and transparency. And if there was a hiccup, you know, I think first, you know, come up with an action plan, to solve the problem. If you're the firm that received kind of the referral, and then obviously if there was something that was significant enough, you need to reach back out across the aisle to the firm that referred the work to you. Say, hey, here's what happened. Here's what we did. And, you know, if there is anything potentially that they can help you with to get over that hump, then that's it. I mean, the client has to come first and their interests have to come first in serving them and making sure you get to the finish line. So, you know, I think it's just what has to happen to do that.
Now, one area that is most common that leads to competitor cooperation in our industry is a conflict, right?
Right.
We can just get conflict. You know, I tried to send you a piece of work and you got conflicted out of it. I know that was very painful, but you have to do the right thing for an existing client, right? So, but you know, talk to our audience, you know, what does a conflict look like? Is a conflict always black and white or the sort of shades of gray where you have to make a judgment call? What does that conflict thought process look like?
Yeah, I think there can be shades of gray. I mean, some are very obvious. You know, let's just, you know, to use an example, litigation that, you know, if we were working for the plaintiff in some capacity, obviously we're probably hired by their legal counsel and we've got an underlying client. But if we are, you know, have been on, and then you look at the defendant and go, oh, well, they're an audit client of Windham Brannon. We're not going to take that on. I mean, that's just a conflict for us. It's not something that we would want to go. And I think there's a direct conflict anyways. You know, some of them can be a little more gray. I mean, this is more of an independence issue that we face as well. It's not gray, but I'll highlight it. So for our auditors or audit clients that have financial reporting issues that have valuation embedded in them, Windham Brannon can't do that valuation work. So we call it independence, but it's really a conflict. We can't produce a valuation then that one of my audit or that our audit teams goes and audits and signs off on it because we're all under the same house of Windham Brannon. So those are obvious. You know, I think sometimes it can be, you know, maybe it's going back to the litigation scenario to paint just kind of a gray issue is you may not have a direct or a perceived direct conflict, but it may be that in this case, again, let's just say we were potentially representing the plaintiff, the defendant, and somehow is on a client of Windham Brannon, but they're close to Windham Brannon. They have maybe refer some work to Windham Brannon. That's just not a position potentially. Again, it's not that we couldn't take the assignment, but you also may not take it because you'd say, well, that's just not a position we want to put ourselves in with that defendant that, you know, the spigot, you know, may turn off or it may create, as you described before, one of those speed bumps. We really don't want to have to navigate that speed bump.
There are enough speed bumps by accident. You don't want to go making them on your own. Right.
Exactly. Well said. Yeah.
So, and you know, another conflict I run to on occasion, which is not strictly one, but I get very uncomfortable with and usually will try to sidestep it is maybe it's not a litigation, but a partner buyout, right? So the client will come to us and say, I want to buy out my partner, or their service partner will come to me and say, we have a client that want to buy out the partner. Can we do an appraisal? I said, well, we could do an appraisal, and strictly speaking, there's no conflict there, right? But let me ask you this question. If we come up with an answer that the client doesn't like, right, is it going to make them mad at you? I said, yes. I said, I don't think we want to do this then, right?
Right.
That's not a conflict with a capital C,
right?
But it's a conflict with a small C with a lot of underlines underneath it.
Yeah, it's kind of managing your firm risk at the end of the day. You know, it comes back to just like I said, just assessing, is that a place or a client relationship that we want to be in and take on? You know, I laugh at it. You turn something away or what you perceive is to do the right thing in some capacity or you lose an engagement for whatever reason. Well, you know, probably within, it may not be 24 hours, but within a week, there's a better opportunity that turns around that you like better than the last one that had some hair on it. So
yeah, that's called maturity. I like to think that in exchange for my gray hair and two arthritic ankles, I get some benefit out of that. And you know, in fact, to that point, I can think of a few assignments which I wish I had not taken. I can't think of a single one that I turned down and I wish I'd hung on to.
Right.
Not a single one. Oh, right. Man, it could never happen.
Right.
So talk about this sort of cooperation. In your mind, do you think you need to have sort of a written agreement? Does everything have to be kind of a papered over joint venture, or can these relationships be sustained on an informal basis?
I think they can. I think it's situational dependent. So we'll go with it depends, which is always a good answer, right?
Jim Hitchin would not like that one, right?
Exactly. So, you know, I think there's, you know, I can think back to, you know, 20 years ago, at a prior firm where I had gone to work with, you know, and I was a manager at that time, but was brought on to help kind of manage a valuation practice day to day that wasn't all the way up to a day to day practice. And before I got there, there were the two tax partners. They had a retainer agreement with one of the more nationally known valuation experts. And, you know, it was the same thing like we talked about earlier. Hey, I got this question, or can you review this for us? And that was padded, you know, with an agreement and a retainer that, you know, the expert, so to speak, just, you know, stayed out in front of. And, I've had it as well where, you know, it's not necessarily padded. You just, you know, hey, I need another set of eyes to see this, almost like a QC capacity, helping me review a project. And there's no agreement in place, but a bill comes and we pay it. And that is what it is. And then, you know, then there's a larger, you know, then you may have a larger project, maybe where it's more of a subcontracting nature. Maybe you're, you know, in a spot that you can't produce all the volume of work. But at the same time, you certainly can manage it with if you're able to subcontract that, and that probably gets memorialized with an agreement, you know, with rates and everything else, and you know, protective language. Yes, we're not going to solicit your client, those types of things. So, you know, maybe a little bit of a long answer, but it depends. In each three of those scenarios, or two of the three, you had an agreement. The other one you don't. I think some of it then comes back to that trust level, as well. Again, we'll keep harping on that, as to the nature of that relationship that you have, whether you need to have it written or not. And then it's really up to both, firms or individuals to figure out how do we cement that.
So one area that some of our listeners are probably thinking about is, boy, I'm not sure I like this. When competitors start to cooperate, that sounds like they're forming some kind of cartel, right? This is how UPIC got started, or whatnot. But you know, in most cases, that really isn't what happens. When we do this, we're not price fixing or anything like that, are we?
No, not at all. It's hey, here's an opportunity. You know, there's no. You know, again, there's no expected, well, I'm going to get this back in return, or no price fixing. It's what's best for our client. So, you know, there's just no, you know, I'd say illicit concepts in the background, lurking in the background, that's in either of our minds and what we've done. And I would never associate myself with somebody with that would have that. You know, to me, the world's too big and there's too many valuation assignments out there that, even though sometimes, you know, you're going, oh man, wish I had another one or whatever, but there's plenty of opportunities for all of us to be fishing in the same pond. The pond is actually really big, and I actually think it's really deep. So, you know, many times for the people even that I know and meet with as competitors, I can say that I'm very friendly with. It's frequent that I don't come up against them even in, you know, whether it's a true RFP or there's an opportunity and somebody's reaching out to two or three valuation firms. Yeah, now I don't come across them. So, you know, it's just the concept, I think, of, you know, again, I'll repeat it, doing the right thing for your client. And who is that most trusted source then that you need to send them to for the situation you have? And I wouldn't expect you to send me every assignment. You may say, this isn't right for Tom and Windham Brannon. It's not something that, you know, doesn't fit Tom's, you know, bailiwick on what he does. So, and I know that you've got other folks that you work with, or, you know, that you spend time with in terms of opportunities. So that's not offensive to me.
Right. We're seeing other people.
Right. Yes.
And we know that we don't have each other's varsity jacket or a letter ring or anything like that, right?
I don't have my class ring.
So I want to draw this out. We've talked a lot about the valuation world, but I want to draw this out a little bit sort of higher level. So, you know, one thing I've observed, and I'm curious about your experience, is that one way where competitors may cooperate is on an exit, right? If you're a company that, you know, you're getting to that point where you're looking for a sale, or for a strategic expansion, either way, right? One of the most logical targets is going to be a competitor, because they understand your business. They probably understand you.
Right.
You may have some relationship with them. And, you know, down the road, that may be a very important value-building relationship. Have you seen something similar?
I can't say that I've necessarily seen it, but what I hear, you know, from the business owners I talk to, and I think you talked about it as well, and I'm not going to say that it's generational, but I am amazed that when you do talk to clients and, again, business owners, entrepreneurs, how much they do know and how much time they do spend frequently with their competitors. And I don't think it's always just at a conference, like an industry conference. And maybe that is where a lot of these conversations occur, but I do get the impression that, you know, again, it's not sharing, you know, everything about whether it be their cost structure, if they're a manufacturing client, well, we've got this technology now in place and this is setting us apart. You're not going to share that, but very much many, I find, my clients do know a lot about their competitors, or if they are looking at an exit, why certain competitors, they would prefer them to be a potential buyer versus others.
So I want to be respectful of your time here. We're going to wrap things up, but I do have a couple of other questions. If we can kind of sum up here, ingredients that go into a good cooperative competitor relationship. We talked about trust. That's clearly one. Are there one or two other ingredients you can think of that help make relationships like that be mutually lucrative and sustainable?
Well, I think I've used the other word that I use is transparency, and communication would probably be the other two words that I think if you summed it up. Again, transparency, to repeat, it isn't just I'm going to tell you everything about my practice. It's here's a little bit about my practice. Here's about our clients. And obviously when it comes to a specific referral, yes, you're going to probably have a name at that point. But even when you're meeting with people, whether it be over lunch or, you know, coffee or a meeting at somebody's office that's a competitor, again, you've got to, if you want to, I'll say kind of be on the receiving end probably, then you need to be, again, talking openly about your own business. So that's transparency. And then that open line of communication is just, you know, be willing to, the other word I guess we'd say for it is vulnerable, as you talked about. And so that just kind of just is a, I think you've got to get comfortable with that. And if you're not, then you may struggle getting to that point, and you're the folks that you're trying to be more friendly with may pick up on that. But, you know, the other thing that I've said frequently is, that I'm willing to be the first one to extend the olive branch in a case. Cause you know, you don't know how it's going to go. You know, many times probably, I don't know if anybody else's lunches are like mine, but you know, sometimes it just becomes more of a social lunch. You have a great lunch, but you know, you kind of go, well, that was great. And I really got to know somebody and I think we could work together, but does the phone ever ring for the work? Right. So, you know, and that, I think that happens to all of us. But now it becomes, how do you become more purposeful? And then, you know, translating that to a relationship. So it's kind of that same thing, you know, be willing to be vulnerable and extend that olive branch to be the first one. Cause sometimes it's, well, are they in the boat with me or out? I have one foot in, are we all in the boat? So, you know, that, that comfort level of knowing that I could extend it one time and I may not ever get, you know, anything that comes back to me or, you know, an opportunity that, that I see come my way.
And you know, alongside that, that notion of vulnerability, I think it's also differentiation and defining yourself, yep. Right? I think if you're in a business where you truly feel or think that it's important that you handle every opportunity that comes through, no matter what, it's much harder to find grounds for cooperating with a competitor.
Right.
Right. And maybe that's right. Maybe that's wrong for your practice. For mine, it's not right. But on the other hand, if you tend towards more specialization, as I certainly believe, I'm a big fan of Rod Burkert, in this regard, he's a strong advocate of specialization and differentiating yourself that way. Then the opportunities for cooperation, I think, become much more obvious.
Right.
And they become much more natural.
Agree.
Right. This is in the wrong box. I know Tom's got this box, so we're just going to do this. And it really just sort of becomes a system. You know, right. I don't have to think about it.
Right. No, absolutely. It's, you know, you got to know your own strengths and weaknesses. And again, maybe we'll call that maturity. It does take some time to figure that out. And as you're building a practice, you know, what do you want to be when you grow up? And, you know, we're always refining that, but, it just is that, you know, that time teaches you a lot. And I still have a lot to learn.
And I will say this, a way that I benefit from cooperating with competitors is one of my marketing points that I use with prospects is that we get about 25% of our referrals from our competitors, right?
That's a good point. I mean, we've touched on it. I think it suggests that you know what you're doing and that you're qualified, because in our world, Mike, as you know, and again, maybe some of your listeners know in your podcast, is that, you know, you don't have to have any credentials to sign a valuation report.
Nope.
There's nothing that you have to do. I mean, you could just hang a shingle and you could be Mr. Hey, I can appraise your business. And it's not all about the credentials behind your name. That's part of it. So that's the first thing you potentially want to look at or consider when you're thinking about looking at a friendly competitor. But then it becomes that reputation, and do they have the ability to do it? And so, yeah, if you can sit there and tell your prospects, yeah, well, 25, 30% of my work comes from my competitors, that, you know, shines a pretty bright light on you, I think, and sets the bar pretty high for you as that specialist in that space.
I found that, I mean, especially since I don't do litigation, they don't even care about the letters after my name. I mean, they don't know what they are.
Right.
Sometimes they ask and they get bored about halfway through. But that part, you know, because when your competitors are validating you, because ostensibly you know how to evaluate me much better than a prospect will, that carries a lot of weight.
Well, and that's right. And I've kind of figured out some math, and I don't know if this is right, but, you know, I've probably reviewed several hundred appraisals of other firms that I get to see their work. So again, you begin to get to see, you get to see what your competitors and what their work product looks like. And so you can begin to in your mind go, okay, just even from a technical perspective, I can trust them or I can't trust them, or are they doing some things technically that you go, I couldn't agree with or sign off on, and I don't want our client to have to, you know, potentially get to a wrong answer because their provider's not doing the right thing technically for them.
So we're coming up to the end of our time here, but can people contact you if they have a question about, you know, co-opetition or cooperating with a competitor?
Sure. Always be glad to chat with folks, or email correspondence. Email is TBROOKS, so T Brooks at Windham, WINDHAM as in Mary, Brannon, BRAN as in Nancy, N as in Nancy, ON.com. And direct dial 678-510-2748 at the office.
All right. And there you have it. That's going to wrap it up for today's program on cooperating with competitors. I'd like to thank my pal Tom Brooks very much for joining us and sharing his expertise with us today. We'll be exploring a new topic each week, so please tune in so that when you're faced with your next business decision, you have clear vision when making it. If you enjoy these podcasts, please consider leaving a review with your favorite podcast aggregator. It helps people find us so that we can help them. Once again, this is Mike Blake. Our sponsor is Brady Ware & Company, and this has been the Decision Vision Podcast.